Glory to God. I thank God for each of you, and we're going to just go on and expedite this. I see you're fanning, but as Sister Stephanie said earlier, how many of you remember, well, some of you remember, when we didn't have air conditioning, we used to sit under the trees and wait for God to send a breeze along. Hallelujah. Well, he's sending a breeze this morning, and I want you to get ready for the word. Just thinking of it, I'm going to call her a miracle woman. Yes. Hallelujah! Oh, God has given her a miracle of miracles. Yes. Glory to God. Yes. You would have to have witnessed it. You would have to have been there. Yes. And you would have to have known what she's gone through for me to say that she's a miracle woman. Yes. Our speaker comes to us. I asked her to write a little bio for me. And I just told her, well, you know, I'm going to have to say a little bit more than that, but I'm going to read what she said here. She is a native of Tulsa, 57 years of age, married to Brother Sonny McClellan, our own Brother Sonny, for 28 years. Amen. They are the parents of 4 children and about 10 grandchildren. Denise received the Lord right here at Northside Christian Center in August of 1980. She excelled in her ministry and was released in February 2006, only temporarily, to follow the call of God. And let me pause here to say, when Sister Denise was released, she was released with Pastor and 9 blessings. And there was no sadness, because I knew that she was on a mission for the Lord. And I knew that when that mission was completed, she would come home. I knew that. I knew it. And so I released her. We released her with our blessings. And just as a prodigal son, she wasn't at the prodigal like that. She didn't go away and waste things, but she came home. Yeah. And in June of 2008, we're so proud to say that she received her minister's license under the leadership of her senior pastor at the time, Melvin Cooper, Pastor Melvin Cooper, let me say. And today she is an ordained minister. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. So we can call her Minister Denise McClellan. Amen. In February of 2011, she felt a release from the ministry to reunite with her family. Let me just say this. While she was gone, all of you might know that Brother McClellan remained here. And he supported her. There were times he would go there with her. But she came back. She was reunited with her natural family, with Brother McClellan in the church, and with her church family. And we are so, so proud of that. Amen. She is excited about the work of the Lord and what he's doing. And she is so happy. This is her note, to be back home. She's so happy to be back home. I know Sister Denise for many, many years. Yes. Pastor married them right here at the altar here 26 years ago. And I know her to be a person who really loves the Lord, a person of prayer. Yes. And while she was here ministering so many years, there were times when she headed up the intercessory prayer. She sang faithfully in the choir, and she worked with the women. Whatever her hands could do, when you ask her, she was so, so willing to do it. So it gives me great, great pleasure. And it's such an honor for me to present my sister, who I love so much, Sister Minister Denise McClellan. Come on, welcome her. Stand with me to the stage and welcome her.
just give honor to you this morning.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord God, that I'm able to minister to your people this morning, Father God, with the gifts that you've given me and trusted me with. I pray that the words that you've given me, Holy Spirit,
yes,
will be a blessing to the hearers. And something will be said to uplift someone. They will not leave the same way that they came in. I thank you, Father, for this opportunity to stand here in your name, in Jesus' name. You may be seated.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to pray for me. First and foremost, I don't want to get emotional. Sharon and I were in the bathroom this morning. And I said, I want to stand here, Sharon. I'm going to speak God's word.
Amen.
With boldness.
Amen.
And I'm not going to cry. All right. So if I do, please forgive me.
That's all right. Amen.
It's all right.
That's good. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
As you all know, I love to turn to the Word. So I hope you brought your Bibles this morning.
Yes.
We're going to start with, you can go ahead and start turning to 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. And you've already been told the title of my message. It's Too Soon to Quit.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to tell you various passages of scriptures, stories that the Holy Spirit has given me, along with maybe just a little bit of my testimony. I'm not going to dwell on it this morning because you've already heard it. Just a little bit of what I went through to let you know that you can go through it. It is sometimes we think that we can't go that extra step. It is too soon to quit. Just keep that thought in mind. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Hallelujah. We're going to start with Paul's writings. He's one of my favorite writers of the Word. I'm just in love with Paul's epistles. 9 and 16 and 17. That's where we're going to start first. Praise God. You know something, just about everything that we go through in life, it requires faith and believing, especially when we come to the Lord. It seems like every time you turn around, if we're not going through a trial, we just come out of one, or we're about to go through one. Amen?
Amen.
And I tell you, it seems like, and believe it or not, saints of God, on the 25th of this month, it'll be a year for me, my miracle. And it seems like I got through that trial, and not only did I get through that one, it was another one, back to back. Seems like it's been going on and it's continuing. But when you're doing the things of God, and you have a call of God in your life, you just better get ready.
Yes.
Because those trials are coming.
Yes.
The Bible says tribulation worketh patience. And I tell you, I've been through some patient times.
Mm.
Patience. Hallelujah.
Yes.
But Paul is saying here, the 9th verse, excuse me, in the 16th verse of chapter 9. For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of. For necessity is laid upon me. Yea, want me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, you see, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. And I believe Paul was saying, we know the story about how he persecuted the church, and on the road to Damascus, Jesus appeared to him, amen? And how he was blinded for 3 days, and Ananias came to him and told him, thank you, Jesus. This is the word from the Lord that I have for you this day, that God has appointed you to preach unto the Jews and to the Gentiles.
Yes.
And you're going to be blind for 3 days. But he said unto him, saints of God, you are a chosen vessel unto me.
Yes.
And hallelujah. How many of you know that Paul went through so many trials and tribulations? And if you can read back, just make a note of this in your spare time, go back and reference 2 Corinthians, I believe it's the 11th chapter, and it'll tell you about all the things that Paul suffered. He said, you're going to suffer many things, Ananias told him. And And how many know at that particular time, if you know you're going to go through something, how many you know that it will probably lead to us to just say, no, I'm going to quit before I even get through this. Because since, as I was reading Paul's writings, he went through many, many things. And I'll tell you a little bit about what he went through. He suffered. I believe he was beaten almost to death. He was left at sea many nights. He was left for dead. He was stoned once, he said, and persecuted by the saints. But remember, he was the one who wreaked havoc in the church, and he began to kill the saints, those that called upon the name of the Lord. So in essence, I believe he was reaping that. But anyway, God had a call on his life. He knew that he was going to suffer those things for the call of God. But in the end, he tells us, even when it got too hard, and I believe it was 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, and he went before God, and he began to inquire him, saying, Lord, please, remove this thing from me. It's too hard. It's too difficult. I've gone through so much, Father. You know exactly what I've gone through. And what did the Lord say to him? Does anyone know what God said to him? My grace, that's what he says to him. My grace is sufficient for you. And I went back to another translation, and you know what? That's what kept me throughout those months after I got out of the hospital. He said, my gracious favor is all you need. Every time I wanted to whine and say, God, win. And I'll back up and let you know why I said that. When I was released from the hospital on September 30th of last year, I believe I met with my surgeon the following week or two. And he told my family to tell me, she has to get rid of that business. Stress is one of the number one causes of brain aneurysm. So, one part of me was sad, but the other part was that God worked so hard. It took me so long, God. And God was just about to get me out there, so to speak. And then I had to give it up.
That's okay.
But all in all, I knew God had a plan. And see, here's the thing.
Yes.
When I really thought about it, I said, God, what am I going to do? What am I going to do now? I was told the best thing for you to do is to file for your disability. I said, okay, this is going to be good. But God had me go through another trial, saints. Not that I don't endure believing God for miracles to stay alive. He said, you're going to have to fight your disability. And I got feedback from different ones who had applied, and they had relatives that had and whatnot. And so when the first time when I went to the Social Security office, of course, you all know they denied me. And I was so disheartened. I thought, wow. And everybody said, well, they deny you. Always deny you the first time. Go back and try again. So I appealed it. And that was about the middle of October. And I'm telling you, it seems like the weeks and the months were not taking long. Because you see, when you have your own business, Sunday where I was telling me, maybe you could pay every day. And God had to take me through that because he was trying to stretch my faith. Amen. So I had to go through that period. And when I would call the Social Security office, they would, you know how they are, they're kind of mean, you know. And I would ask, I'm just checking on my disability, see if I was a clone. We can't tell you nothing. I said, well, I've waited about a month. We can't tell you nothing. So about January, saints of God, I began to get so weary. And I said, God, please, please let me know something. He still wouldn't let me know nothing. I was just about to quit, I'll tell you that. On the 1st of February of this year, I wrote in my word, and I was telling the girls on yesterday that they were about to preach my message, because you don't have to turn here because I memorized it. Galatians 6:9 says, hallelujah,
yes.
Let us not be weary of well doing these and do and will be. Let us not be weary of well doing, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. In my word, on the 1st of February of this year, I wrote, Lord, dear Lord, I'm getting weary. I'm fainting. And I wrote that in there as a note to him to remind him that I had been waiting since the middle of October, and it was now February the 1st. And not only that, God, you know I used to get paid every day.
Yes.
So, saints of God, on the 22nd of February, 21 days later, and I didn't realize this until I was praying for my message. Thank you, Jesus. Can you be cleansed, please, huh? Thank you. I didn't realize it until I was praying for my message that it had been 21 days, and the Lord said, excuse me, I got up that morning, and he said, call the Social Security office. I called them, and lo and behold, saints of God, guess what?
Amen.
You have been approved this day.
Yeah.
I hear nothing else that I'm waiting to say. I began to praise God, and I said, finally, thank you, Jesus.
I was about to quit, saints of God. I really was. I was about to give up, but I had written that little note in my Bible saying, Lord, I'm getting weary. I am fainting, is what I said to him. And it was like, he was telling me, it's getting closer. And sure enough, 21 days later, I'm sorry I'm taking so much time, but I had to do that. I had to get out. But the little stories that I'm going to mention to you this morning in the Word, thank you for your support. I feel your prayers.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
The first one I'm going to go through is about three different passages of scriptures that I'm going to point out. And let me point this out. No matter what you're going through this morning, no matter if it's finances, if it's a court situation, it seems like I'm... I feel in that category. I've been in that category just about now. And... if it's healing, if you believe in God to heal you,
amen.
I've got three passages of scripture that you can refer to and stand on that thing. Amen. I tell you, when I was going through that waiting period, I stood on the word. There were times that I memorized, and kept pulling God's word back to him. And he kept saying, my grace is sufficient for you. My gracious favor is all you need. You don't need nothing else but my favor. And I'm like, God, I know I received your favor, but when? So I was about to quit, thanks to God, but I'm just coming to encourage you this morning. Please, when it looks like the blessing is around the corner and you can't see it, it's always too soon to quit. Benny Hinn said many years ago that hallelujah, he said, God is never early. Listen to me. He's never early. It would be God if he was early. Seldom late, but he's always on time. Amen. When you feel like you're fainting and you can't go on, God will be there to meet you just around that corner. Because if you can see what's around the corner, it wouldn't be faith. He's wanting our faith. And not only that, God wants to stretch us to take us to that next level. Take us to that hurdle. Amen. Hallelujah. I've been through some hurdles, my beloved. And I tell you, sometimes that flesh hurts. It doesn't feel comfortable going through. No, I did not want to wait. Yes, Brother McClellan took care of me, but you know, us ladies, we want our own little money. We want to do things. Amen? So I'm just have to see the whole picture. I've been there where step back, in other words. I had to let God do it. I can't think of the word right now. I had, hallelujah.
Yes, amen, amen. Right.
I had to just step back and let God do it. Humble myself, that's it.
Yes.
As God has given me, hallelujah, another chance in life.
Amen.
So let's go to the first story. Let's turn to Luke 18, please. Amen. Luke 18th chapter, we're going to start at verse 1. And I'm sure we've heard this story. It's one of my favorites also. The widow and the unjust judge. Remember I said if you're facing a court situation?
Amen.
Well, let's start here. And the first thing Jesus said, he spoke a parable or a story unto them, or his disciples, to the end, that men should always pray and not faint. That faint means to never give up. Saying, there was in the city a certain judge which feared not God nor regarded man. This man didn't even think about God, let alone men. And he said, and there was a widow in that city. This is Jesus speaking, of course. And she came to him saying, avenge me of my adversary. Protect me, because this man has wronged me. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God nor man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her. And I'm going to stop there. And I'm going to kind of paraphrase it entire day today. This judge, who has probably handled so many cases, murder cases and all those big, hard cases, comes in from a hard day's job, and he asks his secretary, do I have any messages? And the secretary says, remember that widow who's been calling about 5 times a day? I have a stack of messages for you to return a call. Will you tell that woman, I don't have time. I don't deal with such pettiness. Mm-hmm. All I deal with is the murder cases, you know, the big ones. Mm-hmm. Get rid of her, because I don't have time to deal with her. Next day he comes in from a hard day's work. Do I have any messages? Well, it's probably few messages today, Judge. Remember that widow I was telling about the other day? We still have messages from her. She will not stop. She keeps on. She's persistent. I told you to get rid of her. I've said everything I know to that young lady, but she will not stop calling. She wants you to represent her in court. Fine. The next time she calls, just put it through. Amen? Mm-hmm. And if we read on, it tells us, shall not God avenge his own elect?
Glory.
And then, hallelujah, the 8th verse says, I tell you, God will avenge him speedily.
Speedily.
I tell you, that speedy must be supernatural, because when you're going through, you sure don't feel like speedily. It does not feel like it's speedy, but
that's
God said in his word that he will avenge us speedily.
Glory.
Meaning that God will back us in every situation.
Yes.
He's always there. When the enemy says you can't do it, he wants you to quit. It's always too soon, amen.
Yes.
Because your miracle, hallelujah,
glory,
Lord, is around the corner. When I got there one morning, thanks to God, they had, it seemed like I had thought in my mind, did they hide every mirror in this hospital? I wanted to see what my face looked like. And the Lord knew that. He spared me for 1 week. And then finally, I got myself to the bathroom. I probably wasn't supposed to be there, but I did. And I looked in the mirror, and I said, oh, no, I don't look like myself. Again, the enemy would talk to me. He said, you might as well forget about your little ministry and all that. Because nobody going to look at you the way you look. My face was swollen on this side. I had no hair. It goes on and on. But God is so faithful.
He's so faithful.
And I can remember Pastor Hill coming to the hospital, and Brother Wayne, Sister Candy, and Sister Hill, and all the others, who my family will let get through.
Praise God.
How they, Pastor Hill, I can remember him bending down on this side of my ear and telling me, Sister Nate, you can make it. You are going to make it.
Yes, amen.
I tell you, it means so much to you. Mm-hmm. You have a pastor like that.
Yes. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Yes. Okay, I'm going to start crying. Okay, that's my first story. The next story, let's move on, because we found out in that passage that God would what? He will avenge his people, his own elect. And who are his elect? We are.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
We are his chosen man.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
We're no less than Paul when he said, you're my chosen vessel. We are chosen vessels of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now we're going to move on to finances. If anyone in the house is struggling with finances today, I've got a solution for you. This one absolutely works. I tell you, there is an anointing. There is an anointing on this passage of scripture. I have used it so many times. It seems like every time I pray this prayer, things begin to happen. Mm. And I'm sure you have used it as well. 1 Chronicles 4 and 10, the prayer of Jabez.
Amen. Uh-huh.
I tell you, that prayer is supernatural.
Oh, yes.
And I'm not kidding when I say that. There's something about the prayer of Jabez. It gets things done. Hallelujah. We'll start at the 9th verse if you're there. In 1 Chronicles 4:9. And Jabez was more honorable than his brother. He was set apart. Amen. And his mother called him Jabez, saying, because I bear you in sorrow. But this is what happened. He turned, hallelujah, the odds around. Even though they had labeled him, his mom so pretty much had labeled him as a child that had caused her much sorrow and pain. He said, I'm going to turn this situation around. I'm getting ready to call on the God of Israel right now. Here I am. So he called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my territory, enlarge my coast. And let thine hand be with me, O God, that thou wouldest keep me from evil, that it may not grieve me. And guess what the Lord said at the end of that verse, just like he did for the widow. And God granted him all that he had requested. Amen? So if you, I tell you, I have memorized that passage and used it year in and year out. And it is something supernatural about that prayer.
Yes.
And there's other prayers that I use in the Word. I like Paul's prayer, the chapter of 1 Ephesians. And then, the first chapter of Ephesians and the third chapter of Ephesians, there are prayers that Paul used. Those are good as well. Plus, I use Luke 10:19, I believe it is. The prayer of agreement, there's power in that prayer also. But
yes,
this there's something about the anointing on this prayer,
yes, yes,
that brings in finances, praise God.
Mm-hmm.
It brings in the money.
Mm-hmm.
Try it and see if it doesn't work. Has anybody ever used this Jabez prayer?
Yes.
It works. It really is.
Amen.
Something supernatural about it. Hallelujah. Let's go through to my last story that I'm going to share with you this morning. If you're believing God for a healing, I'm going to take you to the book of Luke, the 13th chapter. We're going to talk about the woman. And all these stories I know you've already heard before, but I just want to kind of refresh your memory and kind of get your faith going.
Amen.
Luke, the 13th chapter. I hope I'm not boring you this morning. I'm not long-winded, I'm not short-winded either. I'm kind of guessing in between.
That's all right. Yeah. Glory to God.
Okay, we're going to start with the 11th verse. And it reads, and behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity. In other words, she was handicapped 18 years and was bound together and could in no wise lift herself up. And when Jesus saw her, he called unto her and said unto her, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. Amen. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately, hallelujah, she was made whole and straight and glorified God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. She was made whole at that very hour. Hallelujah. The same Jesus in Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, I believe, that said he bore our sins, he carried our sorrows, and by his stripes, we are healed. Amen.
Yes, amen.
So we have some time. If there's anything you're going through, I bet you can turn to the Word of God and find something in the Word to match what you're going through today.
Amen.
And if you can't see me after church, then I bet you I'll find it for you.
Amen.
Nothing is too hard, saints of God,
nothing,
young and old.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Just say, I'm going to make it through, and I'm not going to quit until this thing is over. Is anybody going through a trial today? Raise your hand, please. You are not going to quit. You're going to win. You're not a quitter. Because we are soldiers in God's army. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Tribulation worketh patience.
Amen.
And God said, he that endureth to the end, the
same
shall be saved. Hallelujah.
Yes.
It's always too soon to quit. The enemy wants that anointing on your life. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Because if he didn't come after you, you would not be a threat to his kingdom.
Amen.
I'm
Amen.
Telling you, he does try to speak to you. You just have to cast those words down
Yes.
and believe God's word. I want you to memorize that scripture. Find a scripture that refers to what you're going through. Memorize it and just quote it from sunup to sundown, and you will get through it. Yeah. I'm not telling you something I read. I'm telling you what I've been through. Amen. It does seem like you're going to fail. You may have to write little notes in your Bible. I know some of you guys don't like to write your Bible, but mine is just, it's just a mess with writing. Not a mess, but I mean, I just write it all up. Mm-hmm. But anyhow, just write little notes to the Lord and tell him, God, have you forgotten me? I'm still here, God. When are you coming through? If you believe in God for me, God, when are you coming through? If you believe in God, hallelujah, for that house. Lord, I've been waiting, been in that apartment for so long. God, he understands and he knows. And we know all the scripture. Jesus said that I have been touched with a feeling. He's been touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He said, but he was tempted at all points like we are, but he was found yet without sin. Amen. I'm getting kind of tongue twisted. I guess it's time for me to stop. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But I just want to leave that with you this morning. And in closing, I have a scripture I want to leave with you. And it says, hallelujah, the race is not given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but the one, hallelujah, that endures to the end. Remember, hallelujah, never to give up. Always hold on to God's hands. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Hallelujah. If he put it in his word, he means it. He means what he says, and he says what he means. So I just pray that you got something from what I ministered to him this morning. And just be encouraged, amen, to hold on and never quit. Always know that your blessing is just around the corner.
Amen.
Experience what Sister Denise had haven't lived to tell it.
That's right.
Not only did she live to tell it, she's better than before. Amen. Just a powerhouse for the Lord.
Amen.
That delivery was beautiful, Sister Denise. We really, really, really appreciate that. I don't know how many of you really listen to the word. Always too soon to quit. That message. I don't know, Sister Dorothy or whoever came up with that theme. Beautiful.
Yes.
So appropriate.
Yes.
So timely. Because I don't care what you're going through with. I don't care what it is.
Yes.
It's always too soon to quit.
Yes.
As long as you're in the will of the Lord.
Yes.
As long as you're in the will of the Lord and you know you've gotten directions from him.
Yes.
You hold on.
Yes.
I always tell people it may seem like sometimes you're holding on, the rope is gone, and there is nothing but a thread that you're holding on to. Hold on to that thread. Hold on to that thread. Don't let it go. Don't let it go. Holding on to that thread is holding on to the Word of God. In the face of all adverse circumstances, and when your friends and your loved ones tell you, why don't you just give up? It's not to be. You know what God has implanted in your heart. You hold on to it. Sister Denise, you blessed us so much this morning. And we want to know you to know you were a tremendous blessing. And we do have a financial blessing for Sister Denise that's coming. I just want to... she will receive a financial blessing, so we wanted to say that. We know it's a little bit warm. We see you fanning. I would firstly like to say thank you to our president of the Women of Excellence, Sister Dorothy Atoka. Standing, Sister Dorothy, for bringing this beautiful program together. Amen. Beautiful program. And I especially would like to say thanks for her involving people sometimes that We think that, well, I don't know that, you know, they never say anything. But wasn't it beautiful? Wasn't it beautiful? All the way down. And I'm not going to get into naming names. Well, I am. You know, I'm going to go on and do it. We just have a little look. I'll just be with you just maybe about 5 more minutes. Sister Heard, we know she's a praying woman. Amen. But first, let me back up. Where's Stephanie? Stephanie, listen. Is she in the house? Is Stephanie in the house? Where is she? There she is. I heard that laugh. Amen. We want to say thank you for being our mistress of ceremony. We knew she could do it. Amen. We just never have seen her because she operates every Sunday as a praise and worship leader. Thank you so much. Sister Heard, thank you. Madonna, we want to say thanks to LaDonna, amen, so much. And to Sister Yasmin, I tell you, she just come forth, amen. Came up here with her Bible, too, and amen, read the scripture, thank you, Sister Yasmin. And, of course, the praise and worship team was in rare form, as always. And Sister Judy Holman, giving those announcements, I thought, come on, girl, amen, amen. Sister Judy, you are a tremendous blessing. And Sister Irene, you're always a blessing with your beautiful poems. It just penetrates my heart. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. It was beautiful. And Sister Janet Wayne. Woo! Hallelujah. Glory to God. I mean, I thought she was going to sing one number and sit down, but she kept going. It wasn't a blessing. It was really, really a blessing. And I thought, I knew somebody had a voice because all three of the girls can sing. And I asked Brother Wayne once, is it you? And he said, oh, I don't know. And so I said, it has to be Sister Wayne. Sister Wayne, Sister Wayne, you blessed us. We thank you so, so much. It was beautiful. Now we're going to be looking for some more. We know what you're saying now. Amen. And Sister Pearl always can read those poems like, oh, I mean, she really did. Always too soon to quit. And Sister Yvonne Bice is a fireball. Don't nobody tell me that she is not just a fireball. She came on here ready to get that offering, not shy at all, and just was really a tremendous blessing. Thank you so much, so, so much. And we'd like to thank the ushers and also Tia and Derek. Tremendous blessing. We'd longed to hear that for so, so, so long. They used to sing it quite a bit, and I hadn't heard it in a while, but they blessed us so much. And again, where is Sister Dee? She stepped out for a while. Okay, well, we'll want to say, Sister Denise, where is she? Right where? Oh, okay, she's with that. Okay, right there. She moved. Sister Denise, always too soon to quit. Again, I think you stepped out for a minute, but I want to say that message was so timely because you don't know how many people that are sitting here that's going through some things that's ready to just shelve it, just to say, throw in the towel, so to speak. It's not worth it. You know, I've done it for so long. I've been this way for so long, and it's not working, as you were saying, about you're waiting for your Social Security. Some people here today are waiting for something, and they are on the verge of quitting. I hope you heard that message today. Don't you quit. Thank you so much, Sister Denise, because when we saw her in that hospital, and, you know, she was in there, little did we know. Yes, we did. We did know that she'd be back up here. Now, Father, forgive me. We knew she'd be back up here saying these words again. She would be back up here blessing us so much. And I just want to say, in our final words, Northside women, you are among some of the best. And those of you that were not on the program, you get ready. You are the best when I say that, because you hear from your heart. You know, you can. Pastor and I've traveled pretty extensively across the nation, and you can find much larger churches, We all know that.
Yeah.
You don't have to go across the country. You can go across town and find much larger churches. But I want to say to you, you don't find too many people with the hearts that you have. And I want to say thank you. Thank you, Northside Christian Center Women, for giving so much. For giving of your time, your talents, and your resources. We thank you so much.
Amen.
At this time, we're going to ask the president if she has any words that she would like to say. Sister Dorothy, she's coming. Our president, Sister Dorothy Toka.
Yeah.
And then I'll come back with final words. And have you been blessed today?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. I have. Glory to God. Thank you, Sister Hill, for giving me this opportunity. You know, I sat there as each one came up. Sister Yasmin, y'all were like my children. Sister Vice, Irene, every Pearl, every time y'all, somebody got up, my chest just puffed out. I'm like, look at my babies go. Judy, y'all did a good job. Thank you so much. Sister Wayne, you did your little mini concert. We all right. It was all right, baby. Oh, it was such a blessing. I just wanted to tell you thank you. Sister Hill, nobody told me no. Nobody said no. They kind of swallowed a minute. Sister Black swallowed a couple of times. But she, whatever I asked them to do, they did it. And with smiles on their faces. And I know, let me tell you, I knew you were being stretched. I did. I knew that. I'm being stretched. I'm being pulled. And I know what the Holy Ghost is doing for us. He's saying it's time to come up to another level. It's time. You've got too much word. You've got too much faith. It's time to come up to another level. And I just want to thank each and every one of you. And y'all go get a hug from Mama, okay? Because I'm really proud of y'all.
Thank you. And I'm proud of Mom. Took the liberty to get everything together. Normally, she and I get together and said, what do you think about this? It was her. She carried it this time. I had nothing to do with it except for the speaker. Amen. So I want to thank Mama.
I just want to say thank you to the women who stepped to the plate to Sunday. You all did a wonderful job. And don't think that just because this is Women's Day, this is going to be the end of it. We know what you can do, and so we see great potential. So you all make sure that we're a big team, we're a big family. Sister Denise, thank you so much for that message. You don't know how on time that was. Me and my mom, we had a conversation about that this week, kind of, didn't we, Mom? We talked about that, and she reminded me that it was too soon to quit, because sometimes you do want to quit. I don't think any time in ministry, I think there's probably one time a week that you want to quit. If you ask your pastor, he doesn't tell me that, but I know sometimes every week he probably like, I think I'm going to quit this week. But then God encourages his heart, and he knows what the word says. So let's be mindful to encourage those who bless us. And some women, you all encourage my heart. And just to let you know that the best is yet to come, you all just did a fantastic job. And that's all I wanted to say. God bless you. Have a great day.
Amen. Amen. Would you rest with me on your feet, Northside? And everybody, again, we want to thank the visitors for coming, and I want to thank you, Northside, for being here. Well, we're just going to dismiss you with a few words of prayer. Father God, we stand in your presence today with grateful hearts, thanking you for the visitation that you've made upon us today. We thank you for your word, for your powerful word from our speaker today, how our hearts were encouraged. We thank you, oh God. We remember, hallelujah, your blessings that you bestowed upon us. And we just thank you, thank you, thank you. And oh God, we ask that as we leave this place, that you would watch over us as we depart. Be our guide, be our shepherd.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Direct our footsteps, direct our path. the path of righteousness for your name's sake. Oh, Father God, and we just thank you, for you are our strength. You are our deliverer. Hallelujah. You are our high tower. You are our fortress. You are our refuge, a place that we can run to. Oh, God, that we can cast all of our cares upon you, for you care for us. And, oh, God, in those times when we are subject to quit, when we want to quit and give up, when we feel as though we are going through and nobody else has gone through this, oh God, we know that you can succor those. Hallelujah. That you feel what we feel. Hallelujah. And we know that we're not alone, for you are with us. And you have said in your word, when we feel alone, that there's no temptation that's taken us, but such that is common to man. But God, we know you said you are faithful, and you will not tempt us to be above which we're able. But with that temptation, whatever it might be, hallelujah, you will deliver us so that we can bear it. Father God, we give you the praise and the glory today. And as we depart from this place, we pray a special blessing on each individual and on each family. Give them traveling mercy and grace. Hallelujah. We give you the praise and the glory in the name of Jesus. Thank God. Amen and amen. Go with God. Be blessed. Glory to God. Thank you for